then every time I put it on, that's the thing.
That's the focus, and then it's beautiful.
And then Lindsay sent a nice message this morning saying, I'm really excited for you guys this morning. And she said, I'm in the streetlight, so I'm going to miss it. And I'm sad. But she's like, I prayed for you guys this morning, too.
Aw, thanks. Yeah. We're enfolded in love.
Yeah. Sure. I'm just going to check in with the others. Thank you.
Good morning, congregation, and to any guests who are worshiping with us this morning, we welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ, and we're happy to have you worshiping with us. Before we begin our worship, council has the following announcements. To fill the vacancies created by the pending retirement of the elders Brian Boss, Ben Harsevoort, Alvar VandenBuechel, and Art Witten, and for Deacon Case DeYoung, Carl Grunewald, and Trevor Vanderveld, council encourages members of the congregation to submit letters of nomination for men qualified to serve as elders or deacon. Letters must be received before the April 15th council meeting, with the election for four elders and three deacons slated to be held, the Lord willing, on Sunday, May the 5th. A coffee social will be held after this morning worship service, and everybody is welcome and encouraged to join. There will also be a lunch today in the church basement hosted by one of our service groups, and any guests or regular visitors among us are welcome to join for that. Our worship this morning will be led by Dr. Jason VanVliet, professor at our Canadian Reformed Theological Seminary. We welcome you, brother, and pray that we may be blessed as we worship together. As a call to worship this morning, let us consider the words of Psalm 113. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of our Lord is to be praised. Our pre-service song this morning is Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Let us rise in the presence of our God as we worship him on this day. As we come into his holy presence, we are aware of, and therefore we will also now confess together our dependence upon him, saying, Our help is in the name of the Lord, who maker of heaven and earth. Receive now the greeting of our God. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us sing of the greatness, the holiness of our God, hymn 5, all stanzas. Congregation of the Lord, this is the God whom we worship. He is holy, completely, infinitely holy. But as we sang in that last stanza, he is also merciful. And this now, as we listen to the Ten Commandments, the 10 words of the covenant of the Lord our God, is what we must bear in mind. In the first place is holiness. Our sins are not just mistakes that we make, but they are an offense against the holiness and majesty of our God. That makes them very serious. At the same time, let us not despair. There is an overflowing mercy from this God when we confess our sins before him. Let us then listen to the words of the covenant of the Lord so that we may be reminded of his will for our lives. Exodus chapter 20. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter or your male servant or your female servant or your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them. And he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male servant, or his female servant, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is your neighbor's. Let us then respond to the Lord singing from Psalm 19, the stanzas 3 and 5. In stanza 3, we confess that the law of the Lord is like a radiance, showing us the way that we ought to live. But in stanza 5, we also confess before the Lord that we sometimes, even without fully realizing it, the hidden faults fall short of what the Lord requires. But then we will also pray for mercy shortly. So, stanzas 3 and 5 of Psalm 19.
Thank you.
Let us pray together to the Lord. O Lord, our Father in heaven, it is, as we also sung to you, you are holy, holy, and then yet once more, holy. This is how you have revealed yourself. This is who you are. A holiness, a purity, a transcendence that is so bright, so radiant that, as we also sang, the eye of sinful man cannot see you, cannot behold you in the brilliance of your splendorous holiness. And then, O Lord, we know how much we need a redeemer, a deliverer, a savior, an intercessor. Because how could it be that we, who not only have sins that we are aware of, but even so many sins that we're not aware of, we have offended your holiness and your majesty in ways that we were not even conscious of. And then, O Lord, without a mediator, we would surely not dare to come into your holy presence. But with him, who is your Son, who is your beloved Son, who is the complete and perfect rock and redeemer in every possible way, we may not only come, but we may come in joy and in thanksgiving. And we therefore ask, O Lord, that you would cleanse us and that you would assure us of that cleansing as well, that with the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and with his Spirit poured out, that you would completely assure us that, yes, there is mercy to be found with you, there is forgiveness, and that whatever sins we have committed, as we lay them before you, not with pretense, not with excuses, but just with honesty, O Lord, and say, we've failed, we've offended you, we ought not to have, but we did. And then, O Lord, would you assure us that the cleansing is real and it is complete. And Father in heaven, we come each Lord's Day again to also be directed, corrected, encouraged by your holy word. And as we turn to that word now, we ask that you would, through the working of your Holy Spirit, work on faith in our lives. Strengthen, refine, refocus us so that, trusting in you, we may go forward filled with hope. This we pray in the name of our Lord, your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our focus this morning will be on Psalm 123. In connection with that, I would like to first read a portion from Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 18 to the end of the chapter. Let's hear then the word of our Lord given through his servant, the Apostle Paul, Romans 8, verse 18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God, for The creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. There are two psalms that are very closely related. Psalm 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills. Psalm 123, to you I lift up my eyes. Let's sing now Psalm 121. And then we will focus on Psalm 123.
Thank you.
Please turn in Scripture with me to Psalm 123. This is in the section of the book of Psalms which contains the songs of ascent. People of God would especially sing these as they went up to Jerusalem. A song of ascents. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens. Behold, as the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maidservant look to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God till he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us. For we have had more than enough contempt. Our soul has had more than enough of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud. We will sing this psalm together after its truth has been proclaimed. Brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ, your eyes. Consider for a moment the activity of your eyes. Even in the week just gone by, what did you all see with your eyes? Undoubtedly, you saw a lot of familiar sights, familiar faces, family, friends, familiar places, your home, maybe your school, your workplace. You saw other familiar things that you see many days, maybe even most days, certain roads that you travel regularly, maybe certain things on the side of the road that you enjoy, particularly beautiful tree or something like that. You might have also seen some unfamiliar things. Maybe you met a new person, and you're even now trying to remember, what exactly did they look like? What did his or her face look like? Or you went to a new place that you'd never been before. Perhaps you met a new customer, and you were glad to see and meet that person. Unfamiliar things. And perhaps tomorrow, you may see something that you've never seen before and might not see again. It's all in the news. The eclipse, of course. But if you think about the amount of sights, the amount of information that comes into your mind through your eyes each week again, it's simply overwhelming. In computer terms, how many megabytes, how many gigabytes, how many terabytes of visual information did you take in? Hard to count. But one sight that you did not see last week, we can all be quite sure of, is you did not see God with your eyes. This is what we sang about. Hymn 5, holy, holy, holy. God is so glorious, he's so bright in splendor that the eyes of sinful human beings like you and like me cannot look directly at him. We didn't see God. And yet, the psalm, without any apology, without any explanation, simply says, to you, O Lord, I lift up my eyes. How is that possible? Well, you see, brothers and sisters, we have more than one set of eyes. Of course, we have the eyes in our head, in our face, but our soul, our heart, also has a set of eyes. This is what the Lord reveals to us. This is what we also sang about when we sang from Psalm 19, speaking about the law of the Lord our God and how this law, the eyes enlighten. Well, it's not that when you look at Exodus 20, your eyes and your face get brighter. Of course, we all understand this refers to the eyes of the soul. We have physical eyesight and we have spiritual, we have soul sight. And that's especially what Psalm 123 is speaking about, our soul sight, our soul eyes. And the question is, where are our soul eyes focusing? And the psalm encourages, exhorts us to lift those eyes up to the Lord. And as one of Bible translations, a little bit of an older one, but one Bible translation put the heading above this psalm saying, this psalm is about the eye of hope. Because when we look up to the Lord with our soul eyes, then looking properly, looking in accordance with His holy word, our heart and our mind and our soul will be filled with hope. And so I bring you the message of this psalm in that way. Lift up your eyes of hope. Look eagerly for mercy from the Lord, and then also pray earnestly for this same mercy. You know, brothers and sisters, whether we always realize it or not, but sight is a real gift from the Lord. If you, like also me, need to wear glasses to see things, you understand this. Some are so bothered by glasses that they get contacts, but contacts have hassle as well. But to have 20/20 vision where you don't have to have any glasses, don't have to have contacts, that's a real blessing. But more than that, if perhaps because of injury or old age, your vision starts to decrease, cataracts occur a lot. And when someone develops cataracts and their vision becomes cloudier and cloudier, and then maybe they have that surgery, and within about a week's recovery, they can see quite well again. And then they're filled with thankfulness to have their sight back. But now imagine, brothers and sisters, that due to injury or perhaps even from birth, you would be blind. Some people are blind. And they've never seen all these beautiful sights that the Lord puts before our eyes. Well, when you think about that, you start to realize what a gift sight is. That's the sight of the physical eyes in our body. But what about the soul eyes? There we need to realize, and the Lord teaches us this too, for instance, in Revelation chapter 3, that actually we are, by nature, blind. We may think we can see it all, but actually we can't. In Revelation 3, the Lord has to teach also the members of the church. For you say, I'm rich, I've prospered, I need nothing. Not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, here it comes, blind. That by nature is what our soul eyes are. They're blind. And the only way that the soul eyes see is when God gives them sight. This is what the Lord speaks about, for instance, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Referring also back to the very first day of creation, we hear this from the apostle, "For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' has shone into our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the fear, in the reverence of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, this is the gift of soul sight given by God in Jesus Christ through the proclamation of the Holy Gospel. And now the question is for all of us here this morning, what are we doing with that gift? If you've received a gift from someone, you show gratitude by using that gift, not just leaving it there, and you show gratitude by using it properly. What is the right way to use the soul sight that God has given you? Psalm 123 says, look up. That's the right way. And pardon the obvious this morning, but up is not down. We can look down, not only with our physical eyes, but also with our soul eyes. We can look down and around, as the preacher says, under the sun. And what do we see? We see sin, we see suffering, we see corruption, we see brokenness, we see sadness, we see heaviness. We see all kinds of things that drag down our soul. They discourage us, they give us disappointment. Sometimes when it all becomes overwhelming, we feel these moments of despair. And when your soul is filled with discouragement, and disappointment, and despair, there's not much hope, is there? That's what happens when the soul eyes go down. But down is not up. Or sometimes our soul eyes are looking to the left, looking to the right. And what do we see when we look to the left and we look to the right? We see other people. And sometimes we become envious. Sometimes we become jealous. We look at what they have. That could be material, their wealth, their house, or things like that. But it could also be the gifts, the talents that they have. It could also be the job that they have. It could also be the marriage or the family life that they have, or at least that we think that they have. We look to the left, we look to the right. We see brothers, we see sisters, we see other people. And our soul can be filled with more and more envy. And if a soul is filled with envy, there's not much room for hope. But left and right is not up. And up is not backwards either. We can look back into the history of our lives. Sometimes it brings us nostalgia. Oh, for what was. The preacher also says, Ecclesiastes 7, verse 10, do not say, why were the former days? Why was backwards better than these days? The preacher adds, it is not wise to ask such questions. Sometimes we do ask, not wisely. But when we look backwards, sometimes it's not nostalgia, but it's regret. I should have. I missed the opportunity. Parents look back on their child rearing and they say, I should have. Or they look back even a few years. I should have said that when he or she was so young, and now his teenage years is beyond. We look back into our other relationships, family, extended family, marriage. I should have, I could have, but I didn't. And then regret builds upon regret, and that regret starts to build up more and more, and it squeezes out the hope. Backwards is not up. One more. It's closer. It's a little bit harder to discern. But forwards is also not up. You see, you can look forward and you think, okay, I'm not getting stuck in the past. I'm not looking left and right with jealousy, and I'm not just looking down and getting all downcast. I'm looking ahead. But then I don't know what lies ahead. And so when I think about tomorrow or next week, I'm not sure. There's all kinds of question marks. And then anxiety builds up, and uncertainty, and perhaps even fears. And when fears and anxieties and question marks build up, then they can squeeze out the hope. But even though it's a little bit harder to discern, straightforwards is also not up. That's the word of the psalm. To you I lift. Not down, not backwards, not left and right, not even just forwards, but up my eyes. And that can be so challenging to do. It's easy to say. It's so hard sometimes to do. And the Lord knows that. And do you see how the Holy Spirit, so quickly, almost subtly, you could easily miss it, moves from the I of verse 1 to the us of verse 2. It starts off in this personal way. To you, O Lord, I lift up my eyes. But you only get a few words further until he has mercy on us. So our eyes look to the Lord, our God. And you almost want to say, where did all those people come from? Right here, brothers and sisters. These are the other people that the Lord adds between verses 1 and 2. Your brothers and sisters in the Lord, the congregation that he gives you, it's hard for us to consistently look up, up, up. And that's why you need your brother. That's why you need your sister. That's why your brother and your sister need you to come alongside and say, my brother, my sister, I know right now you're looking down, you're looking left, you're looking right, you're looking backwards, you're looking forwards. But come now, let us lift up our eyes to the Lord our God. For when we focus up, then we will see mercy and we will be filled with hope. And you may well have a question in your mind at this point. You may be thinking, but is it so wrong to look down, left, right, backwards, forwards? Can we never do that? Well, there is a place. We'll come to that in just a moment. But first, it has to be connected to up. And let us linger there. To you I lift up my eyes. And when we look up to the Lord and we help each other do that, what are we looking for? We're looking for mercy, the kindness, the tenderness, the patience of the Lord our God, because that is such a big need for us weak, sinful human beings. Whatever we may all need, but oh, mercy. We need mercy. And not just a general kind of mercy, but may we say it this way, a mercy which is steadfast, a mercy which is sovereign, and a mercy which is so completely undeserved. Steadfast. This, brothers and sisters, is the mercy of the Lord. I am who I am. He gave mercy yesterday. He'll give mercy today. And don't you worry. Tomorrow, next week, he'll give mercy again. I am who I am. He's completely steady in his mercy giving. And he's sovereign. O you who are enthroned in the heavens over the earth, the Lord rules over it all. You know, your brother, your sister can show you some tenderness. They can show you some compassion. But they're not in control of everything. They can show empathy. They can show sympathy. But their hands are so tied in so many different ways. But the Lord's hands are not tied, brothers and sisters. He who is enthroned in the heavens is sovereign, and when his sovereignty is matched with his tender compassion, that starts to fill us with hope. Hope which we do not deserve, because it's the eyes of servants who look to the hand of a master. They know the master. We know the Lord. We know what he's like. But he's the Lord. We're the servants. We have nothing to demand. We have nothing to require. We have nothing to come before the Lord and say, Lord, this, this, and this, because no. Requests, as we'll see in a moment, but we do not deserve it. And yet, we can look with this eager expectation, knowing who he is, steadfast, sovereign, undeserved mercy, because when we look up with our soul eyes, we can't see him with a physical eye, but what do we see? You know, Monday, you see it already in the news, brothers and sisters, as they show other eclipses. You see these groups of people standing together, and they're all looking up. They got those special glasses on. They're all looking up together with the physical eyes. You want to see the special thing, the eclipse. But where are the soul eyes looking? We know where these eyes are looking, at the sun. But where are the soul eyes looking? Well, brothers and sisters, when we look with the eye of faith up, 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 to the Lord enthroned in the heavens, what do we see? Enlightened by the Holy Gospel, we see at the right hand of the throne the Lamb of God. And it is through Christ, the Lamb of God, that we are assured that this mercy of the Lord is not some figment of our imagination. It's not some type of delusion or illusion. It's real, and it's true, and through the love of Christ, it's true for you. A mercy that's there for every circumstance and situation of life, and thus becomes so hope-filling. And here we come back to that question that you may have had, yeah, but can the eyes of the soul never look down? We have to be practical too, or in some other direction. First up, and here we come to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, for instance, verse 35. Yes, if we do glance down, what are we going to see? The second half of verse 35, we're going to see tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, sword. There's a lot of misery down here. But you see, we looked up first. And let's help us, help each other to keep doing that. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ, the Lamb of God, seated at the right hand of God, triumphant? It was just Resurrection Sunday. Triumphant over sin, triumphant over death. And when we know that nothing down here can separate us from him who is up there, then yes, keeping our focus up, we can look down and around, but in a whole different way, and in a hope-filled way. Or left and right. Even when we see others and how the Lord gifts them, we don't have to be filled with envy and jealousy because we first looked up. Verse 32, he who did not spare his own son, that's the gift that came from above. And then even as we look down here, will he not also graciously give us all things, everything that we really need? It will come. It will come from him. We need not worry. We need not be envious about that. We look first up, and then even if the eye of the mind turns and looks backwards, even if you have those days, brothers and sisters, those melancholy days where you start to feel that regret, oh, I should have, I should have, I should have. We look up. And those whom he predestined, verse 30, he also called. Those whom he called, he also justified. In Christ, it is right between God and us. We are forgiven. And all of the I should haves covered in the perfect obedience of Jesus Christ. That's the fullness of justification. So even when the eye does reflect on personal history, you can see it filled with the grace of justification. Hope restored. And then finally, forwards. Yeah, that's where the eyes are, eh? In the front. And therefore, we look forwards. What's coming tomorrow, the next day? But when we first look with the soul up, then, as it says in verse 38 of Romans chapter 8, whatever is there, whether it's more life or death, whether it's things present or the things that are off in the distant future, whether it's something very powerful, whether it's a high point, whether it's a low point, whatever, anything in all creation, whatever is on the path forward, this you know, nothing in Christ, the Lamb of God, will separate us from the love of God. It's when we keep looking in this way that the eye of hope is brightened. But then we have to close those eyes too, not to be blind, but to pray. Interesting. That this psalm, you almost think that it could end at verse 2, but it ends with a prayer. And it's an earnest one too. Have mercy on us, O Lord. And then again, have mercy on us. And why is this prayer so intense? Could be many reasons that you might imagine, but here in this psalm, the reason is scorning, mocking, contempt of others. There's something about the voices that we're hearing around us that have a kind of a sneer, a contempt about them. And it's enough. We need mercy to get through all of this. What is the psalmist speaking about? The psalmist is speaking about something like what God's people faced in the days of the Rabshakeh. I remember when the Rabshakeh came? You can read about it, 2 Kings chapter 18. And the Rabshakeh said, on whom are you relying, O Israel, O king of Israel? We, the Assyrians, we've conquered all the other nations. Don't let the king tell you. The Lord will save you. It's nothing but a myth. Nothing but a delusion. An illusion. Look straight. Look accurately. You only have one choice. Give in. This scorn, this mock, this sneer is what the Lord Jesus Christ heard on the cross. Those gathered around below. If he trusts in God, let God deliver him. He saved others. Why does he save himself? And the tone, the underlying tone in all of this is, your faith is false. Your faith is empty. Whatever you think, whatever you cling to in the promises of God, it's not real. It's not solid. Don't bother. That's the voice of contempt. That's the voice of scorn. It's the voice which says either around us or sometimes it even comes within us, brothers and sisters. The Lord is not taking care of you. You're holding onto the wind. And that can be such a powerful voice that you understand why the psalmist says, O Lord, have mercy on us. Because we can't stand against that type of a voice ourselves. But, O Lord, if you have mercy on us and you give the particular kind of tender grace which will help us to say no to those voices, to say no, that's wrong, that's false, it's the only way that we can make it through. Does the Lord answer that prayer? Absolutely, he does. How do we know? Look up, brothers and sisters. The soul eyes, instructed by the word of God, not what do you see, but who do you see at the right hand of the Father? The very same one who was surrounded by the contempt and said, he saved others, but he can't save himself. It's all a delusion. No, it's no delusion. He's there, really, in victory. He's there in power. He's there for you. He's there for me. That's reality. And that's what fills us with real hope. Amen. Brothers and sisters, in our congregational prayer, we will bring before the Lord brothers and sisters whose circumstances are mentioned in the bulletin, and you are probably aware of them, but we will also bring before the Lord our brother and sister, Buitenhuis. Cliff Buitenhuis's sister-in-law in the Netherlands passed away, And we will pray for comfort for the family at this time. Shall we come to the Lord? Father in heaven, we read in your word that hope that is seen is not hope. If we look with our physical eyes, if we even look with the eye of the mind and try to sort it all out and figure it all out, then we don't always see exactly how you are fulfilling all the promises that you make. Sometimes we see it, and sometimes we don't see it, or we don't see it yet. But Father in heaven, when you lift up the eyes of our heart to focus on you, who you are, how merciful you are, how your mercy is so rich, so manifold, that whatever the circumstances, whatever the struggle, there is grace, there is a particular mercy for all of those different things, then, O Lord, we can go forward in hope. Help us in this, we pray. We're thankful that this psalm, too, ends in a prayer. And we ask, O Lord, that when voices around or even a voice within causes us to doubt, causes us to question, tries to push us to question and doubt, then, O Lord, our prayer is this: have mercy on us, have mercy on us, and provide us with the grace that is needed to also say to those voices, you are wrong. Our Savior is the right one, and He is the real one, and He is the victorious Redeemer. Father in heaven, we ask that so filling our hearts with hope, that you would strengthen us to step forward also into this week with all of the various circumstances that we may face. And we then pray especially for our sister Anya Smink. We ask that as she continues to go through recovery and rehab, that it may go well, that she may have patience, and that she may lift up her eyes to you. We also pray for our sister, Lisa Vanderhout. We are thankful that the surgery could be done and that she is now resting at home again. O Lord, we pray that you would continue to be with her, with her husband, Brian, the family. It's been a long journey, and long journeys can also make one tired. But Father in heaven, life is a journey, and you provide strength for each step again. Brian and Lisa have experienced that, and we pray that you would continue to provide them with that. We also think of our sister Beanie Stedinga. We're thankful that she can be back home and is receiving the care that she needs. We pray that the difficulties that she currently experiences may soon pass and that her feet may also be feeling better. And, O Lord, life is a journey, but that journey here below also comes to an end. The sojourn here is over. And so it is for sister-in-law of our brother, Cliff Beitenheis. We pray, O Lord, that as she has entered heavenly rest, that you would also give rest and peace to the family, though every time of death, every funeral facing the last enemy, it is a grieving, but may it also be a grieving in hope. All of these things we lay before you in the name of our great rock and Redeemer, Jesus the Christ. Amen. You now have opportunity to give Christian alms, and after that has been gathered by the deacons, let's sing a hymn of hope, 71. Thank you. receive the blessing of the Lord and go on your way in peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good.